Hey, what's up, guys? My name is John. I'm one of the musicians with Red Rocks Worship, and I'm backstage at our Arvada campus today between services here. I just kind of wanted to give you a quick rundown of our in-ear monitor rig and maybe help improve your experience as a musician on stage working with the app and kind of what should my mix look like. So this is kind of a basic 101, 201 intro video to this monitor experience thing. So we're talking about in-ear monitors, your IEM mix for the weekend, where you're hearing yourself, you're hearing the band, pastor, MD, all that kind of stuff. So if you're not familiar, if you only just engaged with the app, we have different consoles at all of our campuses, but usually backstage, side stage somewhere, we use the Yamaha series or Yamaha consoles. We use QL series. It'll differ campus to campus, but sometimes CL, sometimes QL, and we just got a couple new DM7s too. So this could look a little different, but basically the app is corresponding and syncing up with this console backstage. This is where you're gonna be able to dive into EQs and gain structure and all kinds of stuff like that. So if you don't know what's going on or need some training there, like ask somebody who has a little more experience and they can help you there. But we're mostly just gonna kind of be looking at the app. So the first thing you're gonna wanna do on the app is open the Monitor Mix Yamaha app and connect to the console. So here you can see we've got this Arvada DM7 monitors. I've gotta be on the production Wi-Fi first, so make sure you grab that from like your tech director or the band or something like that. So connect to Wi-Fi, connect to the console, and then you'll see your console once you're on the network show up here. This is the DM7 from Arvada. I'm just gonna click the middle button, connect. Make sure you jump into the right mix, sign into the right mix. So today I'm EG2, Electric Guitar 2. Be careful that you're not jumping into someone else's mix and changing their monitoring experience. So just a few basic things on the app. Over here on the right is your master fader. This controls the overall level of your mix. I'm just dragging it. If you press and hold any of these channels, groups, or stuff like that, it'll mute the whole thing, that channel individually or the group together. So you can see me muting the toms here. They're grayed out there. Up here in the top left corner, you can tab between fader and pan. Fader is just gonna be this main view where you're controlling individual signal levels up and down. And then pan, you're gonna be able to take a mono signal or a stereo linked pair and pan them to the left or right of your in-ear monitors, your headphones. So yeah, that's kind of a basic look at the app. This button up here, top right corner, you can do like a personal kind of group order and group things. This is just gonna be a view for you on your app, so you're not changing anything for anyone else. But that's kind of, if you wanna personalize it and kind of have things near each other, wanna have like click next to your instrument or your voice, you can do that there. So yeah, I'm connected. I'm just gonna kind of go through my mix and kind of show you channel by channel where things generally should be living in terms of volume. For me, again, my perspective is electric guitar player, bass player, backline player, but then also panning and kind of talk through some of that stuff. So yeah, starting with drums here, channel 1 and 2 are my kick in and kick out mics. Again, this is like 101 stuff, so I'm not gonna go too deep into each and every channel, but there's basically two mics on the kick drum, which is the big circular drum underneath the drummer. This is really important for like rhythm, low end, all that kind of stuff, feeling the music, you know? So you're gonna wanna make sure that, you know, if you're an instrumentalist, this is gonna live around unity, which is just zeros in terms of loudness, in terms of volume. So kick is a big deal. And I generally blend the two mics and kind of have them in a similar spot, so they're working together there, and pan should be dead center in the middle. So similar thing going on with snare here, channel 3 and 4. Top is going to be the body of the snare, 4 is going to be snare bottom, which is kind of underneath the mic, underneath the snare drum, and capturing the snares rattling against the head. So top's gonna be body, 4 is gonna be like actually more of kind of like the brittle, crackly stuff in the snare drum. So I generally like to have a little bit more, not as loud as the kick, but still pretty loud, accounting for dynamics and stuff like that. And then I'm blending in that bottom, but just not as much as the top. So toms, I'll pan them just as if I was sitting at the kit. So tom one is usually like a higher rack tom. Two could be a floor tom, could be another lower rack tom. And then three is usually a floor. So again, one and two, the higher toms are going to cut through more. So I like to keep them a little bit quieter. I'll still be able to perceive them. And tom three is going to be, you know, floor tom, a little bit, you know, more body, a little bit more full. So kind of want to, you know, a little harder to perceive. So I want to keep that hotter. SPD is just our SPD SX pad at every campus, and this is going to be for like drum samples, cool like reverberated click snare sounds, stuff like that. This should just be mono unless it's a stereo pair or something at your campus. But again, this is usually when it's being played, it's kind of functioning as like a snare drum, so it's going to live around where snare would live for me. Overheads are linked here. If they're not linked at your location, you can pan them just hard left and right. They're linked for me, so they're already panned. But overheads need to be, you know, panned so you can kind of hear the full expression of cymbals and kind of get a sense for the kit altogether. So that's definitely a big deal. I'll kind of leave them around. I like a good amount of cymbals in my mix, so I'll leave them around like snare levels. Again, if they're gained really loud or something like that, you might want to have them quieter. But loud enough where I can hear the cymbals but still perceive the mics from the other drums, particularly like snare and toms and stuff. Side snare we don't have today at this location, but this would just be like another snare drum, usually tuned higher or something. Drum TB, so TB is just going to usually be short for talkback. So this is our drummer's talkback mic. Good to hear your teammates on stage. You should have those in your mix. Talkbacks are awesome. Channel 13 is bass. This is the bass guitar, the low end, if you will. You know, we've got it just squared up right in the middle. A lot of times I'll see like somebody with like bass panned out way to the left or something, but you want to have it in both ears. This is the glue that's going to hold your mix together. So bass, you know, it's going to be pretty loud in my ears. Loud enough for me to hear the fullness of it without being overbearing, for sure. Sub bass would just be like a synth bass station here, a Moog or another synthesizer, some other alternate bass channel that could be used in tandem or separate. We don't have one today, so it's off. Keys one and two is going to be the Nord, so the red keyboard you see on stage. This is a big deal, you know, to have keys. Usually if you're a singer, this is a great source for your pitch reference. Because if the wrong keys are played, you'll be on the wrong pitch, but if the right keys are played, usually that'll be spot on. So a great source of pitch reference. This is linked for me as a stereo pair. Then moving on, we don't have another keys player, so keys two is muted. Got MD, which is just music director. SL is stage left, so we have two talkbacks. Just one, utilizing one talkback though for the MD today. Have this panned in the middle. Some people like to kind of pan it off to the side so they can pick it out a little bit better, but for me, I like it in the middle. I like being able to hear it in both ears. I'll keep MD loud enough so I can hear what they're saying, but I also don't want to feel like they're screaming at me the whole time. So yeah, a good place is around Unity. If you can pick them out at a lower level each time, do it. Keep it lower for sure, because it's capturing a lot of stage noise sometimes too. But yeah, MD is important to have. Always have it in your mix, even if you're a vocalist, so you know the direction. Okay, so moving on to like guitars and other stuff. EG1 is our other guitar player, Jake. He's panned off to the left. You can see, got him pretty loud. My two channels are linked in stereo, so they're hard panned left and right. And my guitar is living right around Unity. So this is a great place if your voice is gained properly and your instrument's not clipping, etc. You should probably build your mix with your voice around Unity. So you have a little bit of room to turn it up if you need, but also room to turn other things down. A great principle is subtractive mixing rather than additive mixing. So additive would just be constantly turning things up because you can't hear them. Subtractive would be, I'm going to start with what I need to hear and then turn other things down just to the point where I can kind of start to perceive them. So it's subtractive mixing is a great way to build an in-ear mix. So yeah, my guitar right there in stereo. Got a couple acoustic guitar channels. If you got multiple acoustics, pan them to either side is a good bet. Otherwise, just one, and kind of pan it in the middle. 27, 28 are empty. Here's our vocals. So vox 1, 2, 3, 4. These are like leads. I'll pan them, kind of how they're standing on stage. So you can see here, like vox 2 is probably far left. Vox 1 and 3 are a little bit more in the center of the stage. Vox 4 is far right, just kind of, so I can kind of hear what the leads are doing. Vox 5 and 6 would be BGVs. We don't have 5 and 6 today, but a good bet with BGVs, if they're singing similar parts, is to hard pan them out wide and try to match the levels at a low volume level. See that they're kind of functioning as one. If that's not working for you in terms of dynamics or tone or something like that, you can always just, you know, pan one in the center and kind of have like melodic support, that kind of stuff. But generally, BGVs are pretty low for me. I want to feel them. I want to feel the harms instead of being able to actually pick out all the harms. But that's my perspective as a backline player. If you're a music director or a worship leader, you should hear all the people singing on stage and sing well together. Click and cue, tracks, these four channels here. This is just stuff coming from our tracks computer on stage. Click is going to be the metronome that we play along to. Cue is going to be kind of the automated Siri Alexa voice that calls out like sections. Tracks is our stems and loops that we fade in and out. Tracks, hard panned, or stereo linked here, but usually hard panned. Tracks, I want to be able to kind of feel the tracks again and know that they're there, kind of creating some glue without being able to hear every nuance. But if you're playing a melodic instrument, definitely listen to tracks to know if you're conflicting with a guitar part or a keys part or something like that. So be listening. They're gained pretty loud, so I have them at a lower volume. So if you see or hear us talk about Resi, this is what we use for like point-to-point playback. We've got Resi Click and MD from our broadcast location, and this Resi Message would be like our speaker. This weekend it's Pastor James, and our extra Resi Extra would be like if there's a lead vocal or a musical element coming through Resi. So if you're at a point-to-point location, make sure you have those unmuted and ready to go so you can hear broadcast stuff for sync up moments and things like that. CG, this might look different location to location, but CG is just going to be computer graphics. This could be like an audio source for a video or something. Not essential to hear, but sometimes it's nice to be able to you know, work through transitions and everything. 47 is speaker. This is going to be like a live speaker, you know, host or something on stage, campus pastor, those kind of moments. So again, if you're flowing behind them, playing music behind them, like listen to what they're saying and respond accordingly. FOH is just shorthand, so moving on to the next channel. FOH is just shorthand for front of house. So these are our front of house talkback mics, similar to the talks on stage, but this is kind of a summed group of all of the behind the scenes communication stuff going on. So if you hear a voice like asking a question and you don't see anyone talking on stage, it's probably coming from this. Got a bunch of empty channels. Crowd is pretty self-explanatory. This is just the people in the room. These are AR mics, usually at the front of the room, but could be in different locations. If you want to achieve a sense of like space and kind of verb, it's not verb, it's not an effect, but if you want to achieve that sense of space in your mix, you can use this, but use it sparingly. I don't really trust crowds at all. I want my mix pretty clean. Again, you can create that sense of space by turning it up, but it's a little bit of a tough bet because, you know, you might get somebody standing right next to an AR mic. They're singing loudly, they're clapping, they're responding, just like they should, right? But that's going to be really hot in your mix, so use it cautiously. Vox 1 effects, all these are just vocal verbs. Campuses might look a little different. There's like delay at some locations, but mostly just verb. These are going to correspond to those vocal channels, the vox channels we looked at earlier. So if you're a vocalist and you feel like you're in a cavern and you can't really hear what's going on, or your voice feels really far away, vox verb might be cranked for you on your particular mic. So for me, as a musician, I like keeping verb low enough to create a little bit of wash and a little bit of like play in the vocals. But not overbearing at all. And then I definitely use vox verb very sparingly on the BGVs as well. That's an easy way to just really clutter things up in your mix for sure. So use verb, have it sound great, but use it sparingly. And then our last thing, 71 and 72, is just going to be snare effects. This is a snare drum verb to kind of liven that up and make that feel nice in the ears. This could be like a drum verb at your campus or something, but yeah, those are the channels on our console and kind of how I have them in my mix for this Sunday at church. I hope this was helpful. If you have any more questions, like hit up a worship leader or a musician who's been around a little bit longer, and they'll help you through it. So good luck on your journey, and hope you have great mixes for the rest of your life. Sweet. Well, hey, thanks guys for watching the Monitor IEM Mix rundown video. Hopefully you got a little more familiar with the app and the console and got a little more understanding and perspective of how to bring clarity to your mix and how things should kind of just generally be structured. Yeah, lead strong on weekends. I'm gonna throw up a little bit of my IEM mix from this service here at the end, so you can kind of check out how things were shaping up for me. And yeah, be inspired, love the Lord, and make some good music. See you soon.
Okay, we're gonna do some hits on this chorus. 2, 3, 4. Trash out on the floor. Ending. 2, 3, 4, 4. Nice and big, nice and big. We're gonna do 1 of the 3, 4, 5, 6.